Allow me to introduce to the stage the co-founder and CEO of GGWP, Dennis Fong, founder of Jabali, Vatsal Bhardwaj, the CEO and co-founder at Scriptic, Nihal Tharoor, CEO and founder of Latent Technology, Jorge del Val, and BITKRAFT partner, Jasper Brand.
Big L, rest in peace. Rest in peace.
Thank you, everyone. Do you wanna mess with this? Thank you, everyone. Hope you all had a good lunch break and are ready for the second half of this amazing day. So we have here Dennis, five-time entrepreneur with lots of great exits under his belt. He's now building an online toxicity solution fueled by AI. Vatsal, who is a 20-year industry leader in product and tech from AWS, Zynga, most recently CPO, CTO at Skills, and now building an AI-native game engine. Nihal, kind of a very strong, creative, and transmedia storytelling brain, and has worked at some of the world's leading marketing agencies before building Scriptic. And Jorge, who was a previous deep learning research engineer from Embark and EA. So he's been in the field with some of the bigger companies out there, working on the forefront of the fundamental tech. As a first one, Nihal, why don't you tell us a little bit about how you started to engage with AI for Scriptic and the amazing cost savings and production speed enables for you?
Yeah, absolutely. Thank you, Jasper, for those introductions. At Scriptic, we're building this AI-driven storytelling platform really at the intersection of film and games. So, you know, in our experience, you know, the drama is told through the world of our smartphones and apps, and unlike kind of animated story games, we use live action media. So live action video, imagery, audio, the kind that you would see in a kind of Netflix series. And I think, you know, we found that, you know, users are incredibly engaged by this content, but certainly, you know, traditionally, it would be very expensive to go out and, you know, do production shoots and find actors and locations. And so really, you know, we've been very bullish about the opportunity around generative AI and synthetic media for the last few years, and leveraging it, you know, really now as a kind of total solution for the media production in our series. So, you know, we've launched multiple series now where we're using, you know, 11 labs for the kind of phone calls and the audio from the characters. You know, Midjourney for the images, Runway for the video, and I think we're building this really exciting product. And I think the deeper level of what we're building really comes down to the creator tooling and suite that we're building. So really that kind of productization level where, you know, not only can we be using generative AI as a solution for the media, but also kind of having almost an AI co-pilot for creators who want to build their own dramas and for passionate storytellers. And that's really what we're working towards, you know, at Scriptic at the moment.
Fantastic. Jorge, how has it been for you, you know, working on the forefront of tech? Where have you seen the limitations working with a big company? What led to you jumping into your own independent journey? And where are you most excited about today?
I've been in the sector since generative AI wasn't as mainstream as now, and seeing the advances little by little with different algorithms. Now, I was very pleased to see, like, when OpenAI launched ChatGPT, then the whole industry realized that this could be something big. I think that the technology itself is one of the greatest revolutions that has happened in a very long time. And when they started to create images with creative control, I was just mind blown. So I think as a technology, it has a lot of potential. Me and my company, Latent, are not leveraging this kind of wave really, because even though we are generative and we are AI, we are not using just like an interface to a language model or something like that. We are building a new technology to animate virtual characters in a completely real-time and physics-based sense. And for that, they need to learn to walk by themselves. And we use a suite of techniques which are not super common nowadays. So we need to build our own technology. But since there are a lot of technology providers nowadays that they provide that very cheaply in that way, I think that the first people to be benefited from this would be like companies like Nihal's companies, Scriptic, people which are consumers of content to use then in their games and something else. And they can benefit from this huge wave of people trying to apply this in different ways. Then there are a lot of companies which are interfacing with this technology, and there is a bit of hype in the industry, as I am seeing as well, where a lot of companies are, in a way, they're saying themselves that they're building the technology when they're interfacing with it. And in this case, the user interface, the user experience is the really, really big, big thing. So there's a lot of things to be made in the industry. I think that the big point of generative AI, to me at least, is not necessarily cost savings. It's not necessarily making the same thing, but cheaper. What I really would like to see is how the experience itself is changed. We have something that can be creative and instantaneously generate something, news, content, and with the illusion of intelligence. I think that this can reinvent not just the process to create a game, but the experience of the game itself. And I think in this interface there are a lot of opportunities, and that's one of the things that we're trying to do with Latent.
So faster, cheaper, and bigger upside and better experience.
Well, yeah, faster, cheaper, bigger, but a different experience. I think this is the key point. I think AI could enable different things that we haven't really explored so far, rather than making the same things a little bit better, rather than incremental trying to explore different avenues that before were not really possible. We have a spectrum now from fully autonomous and creative, and before we were having to like create every little thing, every little animation, every little piece of content. Now we can have the other part of the spectrum, and there is a lot of things in between as well to explore. So we don't just need to understand this as, oh, we can make everything the same and cheaper, but we can also make different and new things, and that is very exciting by itself.
Awesome, amazing. Vatsal, with the emergence of Roblox and UEFN and so forth, and generally much higher proliferation of indie developers across the board, how are you plugging this all together in an AI native engine?
Yeah, so again, Jabali, we are building an AI native engine for making video games. And I just want to echo some of the discussion we had where, you know, anytime you have a technological shift, cost is the first thing you think of. But, you know, technology is about abundance, and abundance both in being able to create more, but also being able to, like, enable entirely new kinds of experiences. And the last thing I'll say where we are placing a bet on is it's also enabling lot many people to create games of much higher quality than what's possible today. So we look at it as enabling lots of people, enabling new kinds of games, and enabling abundance. And so that's how we are viewing it. And you know, if you brought up Roblox and UEFN, I think those are just fantastic case studies of, as you make the tools easier, you actually get lots and lots of innovation. So that's the approach we are taking.
Awesome, awesome. How does it correlate for you? What are some of the parallels you're seeing? What is new compared to mobile and cloud and other platform shifts you've observed?
Yeah, so there is, again, the way I think of it is mobile, cloud, that certainly drove last 15 years of both innovation and expansion in the industry. But the way the underlying software was architected didn't necessarily change, like the client-server architecture, and you know, you have games running locally, taking advantage. The way games were created, that didn't fundamentally shift. I think AI is going to challenge and change a lot of what we know about game development, both the software architecture, like the way these tools are built to enable more people to create, to enable speed. I think that's going to be completely upended. You're, instead of using, you know, native OS APIs, now you're building on top of neural networks. So that's a big change. The second big change is, you know, how you build a studio.
like, you know, what's the organization and functions and workflows of a studio. I think that also changes very, very, very materially. And the last thing I'll say is, this is such a profound change that it will require invention of new business models to go along with this new platform. And so again, like I, you know, we have a thesis, but we think again, the way software and tools are currently sold in the industry, I think that's also going to materially evolve.
Awesome. Dennis, you've, as a lifelong professional gamer, especially at the competitive high level ends, it gets a little toxic at times, it gets heated. How are you looking at the space and you know, thinking about creating a better, safer online space?
Yeah, so my company, GGWP, stands for Good Game Well Played, and we basically use AI to combat toxicity in games, so in effect, for moderation. Now, we have a much more practical use for AI, at least with respect to what we do and what we're trying to help companies and games do. You know, when it comes to something like moderation, context is everything. And so when I say GG after a match, right, saying good game, that's usually taken as a very polite thing. But if I said GG to my opponent before the game is over, right, essentially implying that I know I'm going to win, now that starts tipping more towards kind of the toxic side of it, right? So understanding the nuances of this stuff is incredibly difficult, even for a human to do, right? Which is why moderation is such a huge issue. You know, I think one out of two people basically have experienced toxicity in an online game or quit playing an online game because of toxicity. And so, you know, our approach really is not just doing it or using AI to try to do it cheaper, which is obviously one component of it. You know, the faster part of it is also very, very important, and the better part is obviously even more important, right? So, you know, the way that we use AI is really to try to understand, you know, part of the advantages of these online platforms and games is that there's an incredible amount of data that you have at your fingertips about what the user's doing and how they're acting and how they're behaving in these games. And so, you know, for us, it's really about being able to take in a lot of different data sources, normalize it to have kind of a very clear and accurate view of a user's behavior, both historically and in that particular context, right? So looking at, you know, for example, saying, you know, F you to your friend probably is not being taken as something that's toxic. You know, saying F me is not toxic either because you're kind of just being hard on yourself, right? So, you know, that's kind of how we use AI, is trying to understand many aspects of a user and how they behave and how they interact with others, and trying to make a judgment call on kind of whether it was intended to be a good or a bad comment. So yeah, for us, it's a much more practical use case. We do use Gen AI, or we've been testing a use of Gen AI, which is using AI to generate a summary of a player based on all of the history that we have on them. So instead of looking at a bunch of data on a user that you're trying to figure out whether you want to sanction or moderate because they're bad, we use Gen AI to generate a paragraph, for example, to kind of summarize that user's history.
Yeah, it's pretty fascinating. When we first invested in GGWP, we looked at what's out there, and not even all of the biggest games have options to report people after the game, which is quite mind-boggling. And then it feels really bad if you're, like, a couple of days later after you've reported many people, you get notification, oh, some player has been punished. So being proactive about this, also live in terms of feedback, is quite interesting. I'd love to dig one layer deeper around kind of the reputation score you're building and what that can enable when you're trying to bootstrap new positive game communities as well, trying to reward and incentivize positive behavior, which is something we haven't seen in games before.
Yeah, so, you know, I think I was touching on a little bit about being faster. You know, for anyone that has kids out in the audience, you would know, you know, it's really important when someone does something right or wrong to be able to give them instant feedback about what they did right or what they did wrong, right? Because
Our goal with GGWP at the end of the day is about using every incident as a teachable moment. You know, it's kind of how you raise kids. And so when someone has done something bad, you want to be able to tell them, hey, this is not cool, here's why. And you know, I think that's what we've learned a lot of is the vast majority of people just don't know any better, right? So there's really an education now because it's becoming more normal, more and more normalized, this kind of toxicity, and not just in games, right? But in any, I mean, if you spend time on Facebook and Twitter, right, you would experience a lot of this as well. And it's because now the kids that are coming into the space and the new platforms, they're seeing veterans of these platforms or games act a certain way. And so they're like, oh, I guess this is, I can be toxic when I'm good or what have you, right? And so they learn this behavior. And it's kind of why we're seeing this downward trend. And so, you know, being able to, and, you know, historically, when you think about moderation, usually it takes hundreds of incidents of a user being reported before they've done something so egregious that it now kicks off a review of that user, right? Maybe they've made a death threat or something like that. And so a lot of times they'll tell, when they actually get sanctioned, this is maybe 6 months later, they actually have literally forgotten what they did. Now, of course, a lot of times they'll say it and just pretend. They know they're toxic and they're like, oh, I don't know what I did. But a lot of times they actually just don't know. And so it's really important to be able to correct them on the spot. And then, of course, the inverse is true as well, which is when someone has done something good, you want to be able to recognize that as well. And so, you know, we've built a lot of AI models that can detect positive behaviors as well. So if someone is helping mentor a new player or being extra helpful, or we have a de-escalation model where if two people are arguing and, you know, a third teammate says, hey guys, let's just focus on the game, let's chill out. You know, we actually can detect those things. And, you know, we really try to advocate for our, for the games that we work with to reward that type of behavior. You know, because you know, it's both the carrot and the stick, effectively, approach.
Awesome. Some of you are building a bit more of own AI technology. Others are more leveraging the existing stack out there. How are you thinking through flexibility of the stack, not getting too locked in as the space is evolving so rapidly? And we've seen some startups who've been 5 years, who've been early to the AI journey, and then big tech has been evolving quickly, and lots more people are building on top of that. Maybe Nihal, you've been at the forefront of it.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that's the kind of interesting distinction on this panel. We've got someone like Jorge who's doing some incredible, you know, novel AI research and development. But really, as Scriptic, you know, we're more of an application of these tools, you know, rather than the AI themselves. And really, we've been building out this kind of creator suite to really have that modularity in terms of what tools we use. I think one of the really interesting things about this space that we haven't really touched upon is around emergent storytelling, which is something that we're really getting involved in right now, which is, you know, I think there's a lot of excitement around, you know, AI NPCs and bringing that into a narrative game experience. But I think, you know, the challenge around that is that, you know, you kind of lack the consistency, that narrative structure that you get from those kind of expertly crafted human narratives. And so what we're building in our tool stack is actually an opportunity to integrate these kind of AI NPCs within the framework of kind of human crafted narratives. And we think, you know, it's actually kind of combining those two things that can be really, you know, something bigger than the sum of its parts. And so, you know, that's really how we're designing out our Scriptic platform and building out, I think, you know, the stories on it.
Vatsal, you've been looking at lots of tech pieces, Lego blocks, towards bringing them together. You've mentioned it changes so quickly. How are you kind of, you know, starting out on this? Where does someone start?
I think you really just got to start with, you know, the kind of the value proposition at the end of the, you know, what you're doing. You know, it's got to be about driving, you know, more immersive narrative experiences for the player. And so, you know, whether that's in the kind of the content creation piece, of building out these live action interactive dramas on Scriptic and leveraging these tools, or whether that's in the kind of the live environment around, you know, players, for example, you know, in our experience, you know, some of our stories are available on Netflix now. You know, players are kind of spending, you know, 4, 5, 6 hours with these characters. You know, the value proposition, you know, of our experience is that you feel like the lead character in the Netflix drama. And so, you know, the opportunity to kind of come back and engage with those characters, you know, in a kind of natural language way is really powerful, because they're not just AI bots, they're characters that you're intimately connected with because you've gone through an expertly human crafted narrative. And so we think there's a really powerful, you know, kind of balance that we're establishing between the human craft and their generative counterpart. And so really that's where our kind of focus is at the moment. You know, we think if we can kind of find that really strong balance, we can really create that, you know, living and breathing world. And actually, you know, these characters almost, you know, it almost becomes a social mechanic. You know, in the way that players come back to hang out with their friends, they're coming back to hang out with their favorite characters. And their characters know them personally and have those shared memories. But there's still that core human-crafted narrative that punctuates it, that's of the quality bar of an HBO drama, and allows that kind of emotional engineering between the player and the characters. And so, you know, this is, you know, these are the questions and worlds that we're kind of interrogating and figuring out right now. But I think it has to be that balance. And, you know, we're looking, you know, whether it's in world, I know doing fantastic work here, and there are other AI NPCs and generative agent companies out there, but it's about, you know, the ones that can really, we can deploy to achieve those goals of, you know, even more immersion and attachment with the experience.
Yeah,
so I just want to jump in. I agree with a lot of what Nihal was talking about. I think the one thing I'll say is, yes, there is a lot of change, but there is also a lot of noise. And so the way, at least, you know, we are approaching it is grounding ourselves into what we think of as, like, what are the durable customer problems we are seeking to solve? And that's the filter we use to actually look at, you know, if there is a paper, demo, what have you, once it comes out, on does it fit? I think that's the first way in which, at least from the side of building tools and platform, we are approaching it. The second one is, like, what are, you know, some of those key problems and primitives which we want to build towards? So there are some of those primitives we have identified. And again, we look at, like, which of these changes directly impacts our ability to deliver much better experience. We'll adopt those. The rest we'll ignore for now, right, if they don't fit with what we are seeking to solve. The last piece I'll say, and this is purely from a software architectural standpoint, is just decoupling. There is a product experience we seek to deliver, and then there are components we are building. So we look at ways in which, you know, can we build a modular, much more microservices type architecture, which can enable us to move quickly as new things emerge, which fit better. So at least that's our approach. Because yes, things have, you know, in last few years, there were GANs last three, four years ago. You know, Nihal might remember, and now there are transformer-based and diffusion-based models, and in future, there might be interesting pairing of expert-based systems with transformer models and symbolic AI coming back in. So yeah, you have to stay ahead, but then again, use a strong filtering of what fits.
Jorge, you want to jump in on that?
I don't have much more to add, actually, to that. I agree with everything they said. I agree with the point of being pragmatic about what you're using. It doesn't matter, GAN, transformer based at some points. You need to know what it does as a consumer of it. If you're a researcher and you want to dig into that, then of course you need to know how it works. And it's always helpful to know how it works, especially if you're developing other kind of technology. But being pragmatic and having a strong vision about what do you want to achieve with these things. For example, Nihal was talking about emergence and immersion. I think those are components of a strong vision. For example, trying to bring something new to the table. And AI can give us this. It's one of the first things in years that has the actual power of giving us a fundamentally new and fresh experience. I think games have been fundamentally working in the same way for decades, and we have lately been playing the same games, you know, just different numbers after them or different names. But they're essentially very, very similar games. So I think we do need new things to the table, and those new things need new technologies and need brave people that propose strong things to do with those technologies. So being pragmatic and being brave to use these kind of things in a way that is non-orthodox at first, I think those are the important things.
Awesome. How are you thinking through the value of the data that game studios get to collect? Of course, we had kind of economic simulations happening in games like Eve, and real-world economists from their chalkboard could test their theories. How are you all thinking through the value of data versus value in the model itself?
I can go. I mean, I think a lot of people, when you think about the AI revolution and kind of where why people are so hyped about it, you know, I think to what Vatsal said, there's a ton of noise. And there's a ton of noise because the vast majority of startups and companies that are AI companies are basically just front ends to the same set of data, whether it's OpenAI or otherwise, right? And they can rise really fast before people recognize that it's just a front end. I mean, the one that comes to mind, sorry, Jasper, is Jasper.ai, which was a copyright, you know, copywriting startup that went from like zero to 100 million in revenue in like 2 years. You know, they raised a bunch of money on the backs of that, but basically they were just ChatGPT skinned, right? And they were very, very early. And now that people realize you can just use ChatGPT for it, you know, now they're struggling greatly, right? And I think you see a lot of companies, you know, I think that contributes a lot to the noise. But, you know, I think that's partly the revolution that we've seen is, you know, the OpenAI has access to an insane wealth of data, which is why you can build such cool things on top of it. You know, and I think, you know, the quality of an AI company often comes down to the quality of the data set that they have and whether it's proprietary or not. And so, you know, I just at a very high meta level, you know, I think, you know, the Googles of the world and Amazons of the world are probably going to be massively underestimated because they haven't fully unlocked the value of the data that they have. And I think that's also the case for games as well. And I think that's the biggest challenge that every AI gaming related startup has is, you know, the reality is most companies, most successful game companies already use AI and ML inside their companies. They just didn't build it in a way that was intended to be generalizable and to be resold to other people. And so, you know, I think that's the part that's probably the most challenging for AI startups is, you know, how do you get access to a proprietary data set that allows you to build really unique and custom models? And you know, you need access to data that literally nobody else has, right? That's one of the advantages. You know, at least to me, you know, there's certain companies that have built in distinct advantages because they already have access to a ton of data.
Also, just to jump in 1 second, the amount of data that OpenAI and Google and the rest use to train these models is immense, and it's not something that can easily be competed with. And the cost of training these models is astounding as they are now. So what people typically do is fine-tune these models with a little bit of data. I can say that it works even if you don't have that much data, because the prior given by the data that it was trained on is very strong. So in the previous companies I worked for, we did fine tune these kind of models, but they were not access to ChatGPT and all of that because it wasn't there. But we did fine tune some of these models with very little data, and it sort of worked. So even if you have an idea that, and you don't have like billions of data rows or something, you can still do something, but you will need to rely on pre-trained models. And in this case, you would need to work with Anthropic or OpenAI or all of those. So I think it's a good point to realize that right now these companies have some moat that is really, really hard to go directly against. So the best way is collaborating with this or using some open source model and fine-tune it with your data. And yeah, apart from that, I completely agree with Dennis as well. Like, the value of the data is super important, and it's easy to realize that it's very, very hard to get in practice some of those. In our case, the data that we mostly use is motion capture data, and it's very hard to get even from our case. So in the end, we're gonna end up just recording it ourselves, just like a lot of companies end up just producing their own data.
Yes, one thing which I'll add, by the way, and just Dennis and Jorge, you said it well, is you often underestimate how valuable just a smaller data set, but which is very, very high quality and specific for the task is. I mean, I think sometimes you get caught up on, like, how do you need lots of data? And like ChatGPT, OpenAI and Microsoft and large companies, they have lots and lots of data. But I think the way you counter it as a startup or as an entrepreneur is to look at the vertical and look to gather very high quality data for that particular use case, because that's where you can actually rely on these models for natural language, for conversational abilities, but then deliver something which is unique and unmatched.
Yeah, I think that's very true. If you're thinking about the gameplay experiences on top of it, Nihal has it on the personalized play experiences and kind of that empathy building that you have with the characters, whereas you would need to invest so much more in IP and the characters and storytelling around it to try to create that. But also, if you're trying to adjust the difficulty levels, learn, you know, what type of help a player needs at different points in time, it's not that deep of a data pool that you need to adapt it as a new player comes in. As we're looking at the time here, kind of perhaps as a final one, where do you kind of see the largest untapped opportunities, or also some of the hardest challenges that are yet to be solved for you?
Yeah, I mean, I just think in the narrative game space, it is really about, you know, cracking this whole puzzle of emergent storytelling. I think there's such a huge opportunity around it, but you know, the use cases that we've seen for it haven't really, we feel, managed to pull that off because apps like AI Dungeon, which just kind of get completely lost the narrative. You know, you don't even know, you know, where you are, and it's lacking that coherence and consistency. So for us, I think, you know, when we get past that novelty, I think, you know, the success stories in the AI storytelling space are really going to thread, you know, the kind of generative agents with ultimately human crafted narratives. And I think, you know, for the foreseeable future, those two things have to be in tandem, and we can't completely let that out of the box. And I think the ones that are able to balance it and thread it together into something bigger than the sum of its parts will be, you know, the real winners in the space. I think that's certainly where we're trying to push the envelope in Scriptic.
Yeah, I mean, for me, I think from an AI perspective, what I get really excited about, particularly for this industry, for gaming, is it's an incredible force multiplier, right? Particularly around speed and efficiency. I played a lot of New World. It was a game by Amazon that came out, I think it was a couple years ago. And, you know, my friends and I, we played it, and it was a new MMO that came out that was actually incredibly fun. But, you know, it's extremely expensive to go build content for MMOs, and literally we just ran out of content, right? So they launched, it was great, we had a lot of fun. We wanted to keep playing, but there was really nothing else to do. I think a lot of the players that played that game felt the same way. And so, you know, to me, you know, from an AI perspective, being able to be able to essentially auto-generate content, you know, new quests, new maps, new characters, narrative, all of that stuff, you know, that's where actually the vast majority of the cost of a game comes in is kind of the scaling horizontally at the end of the day. And so for me, I think we're at a really interesting time in the industry just because a lot of these tools, people are building these tools to make it easier. So instead of having to build it in-house from scratch within a company, you know, there's a number of startups that are building these tools to make it easier for games to be able to scale horizontally and to be able to ship content in a much more, not just cost-efficient manner, but speed is actually incredibly important because, you know, New World eventually shipped new content, but it was like 6 months later and everyone had already quit the game because there was nothing to do. And so if you don't, you know, I think that there's a world in our not too distant future where you're not going to have that problem anymore because you can leverage Gen AI to do a lot of it. And I think that to me is pretty exciting, both as a player and as someone that works in the industry.
Yeah, I will just very quickly say that to me, one of a challenge which is hard is the trade-off between creative control and emergence. In all Gen AI in general, if you want to control too much, you will not gather as much value from the AI as you can. And if you don't, then you have a problem because people want to control what goes out of the algorithm, whether if it's narrative or physical behaviors and all of that. It's a hard trade-off to get right. And it's also a technical challenge, which I'm sure will be solved as we go. But nowadays, I think it is.
I'll just add to back what I was saying. I'm excited about the abundance. So like more people creating higher quality games, invention of new kinds of games. And I think the challenges I would say is it's easy to get excited, but Gen AI, LLMs, they are still nascent. They can be fragile. So being thoughtful on where they are actually additive versus being a subtractor, I think that's the needle which we'll have to thread. The second one I would say on challenge is like around people, especially you know, if you are a large studio looking to adapt. Like the technology figures itself out. Like you can solve it. But I think it's the people aspects, which some of the earlier panels hinted at, which will probably be the most challenging.
Awesome. Thank you so much for all the great insights. Super fascinating stuff. And great to hear about the different angles of attack you have to the space. Thank you, everyone.